Green Sleeves. That version is from the brand new album from Mark O'Connor called Markology 2, and Mark O'Connor is on the line. Welcome to WLRN, Mark.
All right. Thanks very much. Thanks for playing it.
Congratulations on the new album, and I'll start off by asking you, I know the song Green Sleeves, and I know there was the song Green Sleeves somewhere in what you were playing. What were you doing there?
It was really an improv jam, wasn't it? I had some different ideas. It was interesting, like, my return to the guitar after a 20-year layoff, I kind of wanted to revisit some old standards and just kind of reinvent them. They've been played so many times over the years by guitar players, especially, and by myself. I played some of these pieces on the new Markology 2 album, since I was 12 years old. So I wanted to really kind of test whether I was going to come back as a new guitar player with new ideas, or just kind of regurgitate the ones I already had the last time I had played guitar. And so I really made a conscious effort to just kind of re-engage with the creativity part and just take them to a whole new place.
You hadn't played guitar, you said, in 20 years?
Yeah, I just picked it up again in 2017. After putting it down for 20 years due to bursitis and tendonitis issues in my right elbow from flat picking, thankfully it didn't affect my violin playing nearly as much, although I had to watch it. But there was something about what I was doing on guitar back in the 90s that just blew it out. And so I just set it aside just to try to save my violin playing career. And then in the last few years, I just got reinterested in the guitar again. And I was able to approach it, with a little bit more of a maturity that was watching out for potential injury and, not overly practicing to the point where you're pushing yourself, into the threshold of having pain.
That must have been pretty scary times back in the 90s when you thought your livelihood was threatened.
Yeah, I had to quit everything for a couple of months. I couldn't even move my arm. It just goes to show you that that I think that a lot of young musicians, can injure themselves through repetition, practicing, especially rehearsing. I don't think a stage performance really affects the injury that much. I don't hear that much about it, and I've never really experienced it from performing. So it's just really about discipline. If you have a tweak in your arm, it's best just to set it aside for half an hour or an hour or even the day, and then revisit the next day. So that's what I've done with the guitar, and it's worked.
Were you taught the wrong way?
I don't think so. I think that, a lot of classically trained violinists get injured, with the, the most scrutiny of technical training you could buy. So it's really just the nature of the physicality of performing, using those joints and muscle groups, and in a repetitive motion.
So this album, Markology 2, is really your first solo guitar album.
Well, it's the first solo guitar album since the one I was 16, which was Markology. And I kind of wanted to make that tie-in. Very seldom in life do you get to do a 42-year sequel. A follow-up 42 years later, and so I wanted to play on that. And also one of my guitar mentors who helped me with the first Markology album when I was 16, Tony Rice, he had just passed away, so I wanted to dedicate this album to his memory.
Well, let's talk a little bit about Tony Rice. You when did you first meet him?
I was 13, and met him when he was still with J.D. Crowe, and we hung out a little bit, and then Then he joined the David Grisman Quintet the following year, and then I sat in with him and David when I was just 15. And then I had the opportunity to record that guitar album, and Tony helped me with it, and he helped me mix it and so forth. And he became a mentor during that time. And then we did a lot of playing together the following year. But it worked out that I was going to join David Grisman instead of Tony Rice. But we caught up, you know, through the years playing different, you know, bluegrass jam sessions and television specials and whatnot. And so, you know, he started out as a hero and then became a mentor and then became a colleague. So a full-scale journey with my relationship with Tony Rice.
What was it about Tony Rice's playing that made him the legend in bluegrass guitar music that he is?
Well, he was better. He was better than anybody else for starters. But he also came with a new approach, a more refined sound and style, you know, a technique and musical ideas. I mean, he really opened the door to in a field that there wasn't that much history in exploring the guitar as a lead instrument. I mean, you can't go, you know, much further back than Doc Watson really made a huge contribution in bluegrass lead guitar playing, solo guitar playing, you know. So it's not really a very old genre, if you will. And Tony Rice would be the second generation after Doc. Same here. I guess I put myself in the same generation as Tony, although I was always a little bit younger because I started out so young. So I was younger than a lot of my colleagues. I was playing in groups with them, and a lot of my colleagues were about 10 years older than me. You know, Tony Rice, Sam Bush, David Grisman, all that bunch, Jerry Douglas. So, yeah, he just broke down the doors, you know, and just came in, and he became the legend that he did. And, you know, personally, I would credit his guitar playing to really inspire my own, even as a young teen, although I was really heavily influenced by people like Clarence White directly and Doc Watson and Norman Blake. And Dan Crary, really the only other prominent bluegrass flat pickers, you know, on the scene. They were all my heroes, you know, because they were not only the only ones, but they were all, you know, just my first go-to. I loved their albums. I loved getting to know them and play with them. And same with Tony. And he just became, you know, just a cut above.
Yeah, Tony just recently passed away. Mark O'Connor is on the line. And Mark, you mentioned I always thought of you as a peer of Tony Rice and David Grisman, but you are younger. In fact, I think you have the record for being the youngest signed contract, and that's when you were 12 years old?
Rounder Records. I was signed to their label and did 6 albums with them. And I was very young when I signed with Warner Brothers as a artist producer. I was also I wasn't the youngest artist, but I was the youngest artist producer, or one of them, at least out of Nashville. And when I signed with them, when I was 20, about 22 or 23. So yeah, it's been really an amazing thing to kind of just hang in there this long and kind of be a little bit of an elder statesman now.
Well, if you were at 22 and 23 years old, what kind of projection did you see yourself in the music business?
Well, you know, you as an instrumentalist, you hear from a lot of people. Everybody from people inside the business itself of music to fans, to relatives, you know, to friends, that, you know, you're not going to probably make it as a musician because, you know, you're this eclectic instrumentalist, you know. And, you know, it's easy to understand that viewpoint because there's not many people you can point to and go, see, they made it, you know. there was always something that I felt I could get there through my creativity. You know, it wasn't just the fact that I could play well, but I played multiple instruments, and I wrote for those instruments, and I had interesting ideas and settings for the instruments. And I think that's what really made the difference for me. I have so many albums to now showcase all those differences. I mean, even with Markology 2, you know, it's just a solo guitar album, right? But it's really quite interesting because it's so rare that there's a solo guitar album played with a flat pick. When you think of most time, when you think of solo guitar albums, you think of finger style, you know, whether on steel strings or nylon strings, depending on the genre. But it's so rare to take a flat pick and create solo repertoire from it with no accompaniment. And that is just a really unusual thing, especially in bluegrass, but for any style of music, jazz or any kind of new acoustic music, or frankly, electric guitar. When you play with a flat pick, you think automatically, okay, I'm going to strum and accompany something, maybe accompany a vocal or accompany another soloist, or I'm going to take the flat pick and play lead, and people are going to accompany me and fill in behind me. So I created this kind of style that you hear on Greensleeves and other tracks that your listeners will hear, where I'm kind of using the flat pick to create this kind of cross-pollination between strumming and lead playing with flourishes and whole kind of sections of tunes where the lead becomes strumming, if you will. And it just breaks it up. It makes it, I think more orchestral in a sense, where the guitar becomes a bigger viewpoint. It has is a larger structure to it, the dynamics, the textural changes, the color of the sound changes. So there's a lot more dynamics going on.
Is this a sound that's in your head, or are you trying to duplicate something or written it down?
Well, I think that the 20 years off with no guitar allowed me to bring in my other influences and experiences. What I've been mainly doing during those 20 years is my classical composing and performing. So I had, you know, string trios, string quartets, and I was playing a lot with symphony orchestra with my concertos. So all of a sudden I'm picking up the solo guitar and it becomes a new instrument with that type of, 20-year experience going into it. So it took me, it took me a matter of just a few months to get my calluses back, and then I could certainly move my left-hand fingers because I've been playing violin this whole time. It took me a little while to get the discipline of the right hand back, but as soon as I was getting that back, then I started to think of the guitar in a new soundscape, if you will. It was a kind of a reinvention.
Mark O'Connor is on the line, and we're talking about his new album, Markology 2, a follow-up to Markology 1 that was released 42 years ago. Well, let me play another song from it. Beaumont Rag is a traditional tune. Is there as much improvisational in here as well?
Yeah, there a lot of these pieces on the album, there's some improvisation, like in Greensleeves, and then I narrowed it down to, I like that version that I recorded. With other examples like Beaumont Rag, I really worked on variations. This is really a theme in variations that takes Beaumont Rag way out there, further than I'd ever taken it.
Let's listen to Mark O'Connor's version of Beaumont Rag.
Thank you.
Beaumont Rag, Mark O'Connor, from his new album, Markology 2. There's so many things I want to talk about. One is, to start off with, is your online presence. Almost all the songs on the album is you have a YouTube version, and also you've been doing weekly shows with your family from your home. I guess you've adapted pretty well.
Well, you know, the first month of the pandemic, I was thinking, okay, you know, collectively, all the musicians in the world, we're all in this, but we'll probably come back online here in a couple of months. And then month two came, and I'm sitting there going, you know, this could be a while, and I'm going to go crazy if I don't have some kind of musical outlet. And so I started to think about creating more guitar arrangements. I didn't really have the idea that I was actually creating an album yet. I just was going song by song, working up arrangements and then recording them. I didn't necessarily know where it was going to lead, but I knew performance vehicles. So we started Mondays with Mark and Maggie, my wife, Mondays with Mark and Maggie. And we're on our, we'll do our 48th show this Monday. And we've not missed a Monday since we started up in June. It took me a couple of months to get the equipment together. I had never streamed before. And I knew, I mean, I didn't know much about it. And I knew that I had to really know a lot about it if I was going to be the engineer, the person that was running the cameras and the sound all inside our home. So it took me a couple of months to get the gear together and to see what was working for us. I wanted to make sure that the sound was really incredible. And we ended up using these stage microphones that Maggie and I have been using for a couple of years, and they work just great. And we've got a three-camera system. Actually, I'm kind of coming through you through Zoom right now. Yeah, so it's really, that has really been a lifesaver because, I mean, you know, since I was, 12 years old, I've been performing, and I don't know if I've ever not performed, often at least. And so it just makes me feel like I'm home, that I've got some kind of outlet to play, you know, and play for some kind of audience. And so we've got subscribers and ticket holders. You can go to markoconnor.com homepage. The viewers right there, and the ticket and the subscription sales are right there. And we're going to keep it going for a long time because we still don't have any dates booked until early 22. They were all, you know, originally postponed and then ultimately canceled. I think that's what happened to a lot of musicians, is that they were postponed for, you know, 4 months or 6 months, and then ultimately canceled. Those contracts were canceled, and then everything had to be renegotiated, and a lot of the theaters that we were working with have, you know, dramatically changed their personnel or schedule. So, you know, it's kind of like starting over. And so it's been really a huge impact for musicians. And we were, and Maggie and I were certainly two of those musicians that were really impacted by this.
I know the University of Miami used to have you come down quite often to help with their music program. Do you know if that is going to continue in the future?
Well, I had really a wonderful relationship there for 5 years. I was artist in residence there and did a lot of wonderful things on campus with different student groups, taught in that capacity and introduced a lot of new ideas for string playing. But, you know, I think they moved to other artists in residence.
I see. Okay.
You know, to and so 5 years is a long time. I mean, you know, anything beyond that, I mean, you'd have to become a professor there or something. And I wasn't quite ready. I didn't really want to do that. I was mainly a touring artist. And although, you know, I mean, the older I get, the more that might sound more attractive to have a teaching base at a university and then, you know, still have a schedule of touring.
Mark O'Connor is on the line. Speaking of teaching, you've created the Mark O'Connor method, which last time I talked to you, you said you were challenging the Suzuki method. And have you had much for moving forward with that?
Yeah, it's been really very consistent as far as people coming to the book series and teaching from it. I hear a lot from teachers that they're using it. And their kids love it. I've never heard from a teacher that their students don't like it. And some teachers might choose not to use it because of their personal preferences in music or literature or style, or they have something of their own they want to do or promote with their students. But it's been really amazing. I mean, it has kept at the same clip of growth over this 12 years that has been out. And I've added more books to it. It goes up to book 5 now, which I would say the conservatory level for American violin. I'm going to actually prepare to do a new repertoire book for the O'Connor Method using my caprices, including the most recent caprice I just composed for the Yehudi Menuhin International Violin Competition, which is actually taking place this week. And they're using this newly written caprice of mine for the competition. So the top young violinists from around the world have to learn and memorize my caprice as a part of the competition repertoire, along with their standards that they are required to do from Mozart to other composers. So it's really I still have my hand in that world big time. And then, of course, that feeds the O'Connor Method idea that that classical musicians should know a lot more about American string playing. And I think that idea is really catching on.
Mark O'Connor is on the line. Well, you have delved into classical music quite a bit. One of your first compositions, the Fiddle Concerto for Fiddle and Orchestra. It's interesting you say the word fiddle instead of violin. Don't you get paid more if you used violin?
Yeah, you would think so, but there's also a lot of broke violinists out there too. So you know, nothing is the silver bullet when it comes to this instrument. But in actuality, the name really was branded. I didn't really put much thought into it other than it was so unusual. Fiddle concerto. Those two words usually do not go together, actually ever went together before I did it. And I think that was part of the thing that kind of broke through was here's something that is really brand new. And so that was my first one. And then I, composed a series of other violin concertos. And then I end up a few years ago composing my 9th concerto. And that's called the Improvised Violin Concerto, which is yet another sequence of words that you will never hear together until my piece, the Improvised Violin Concerto. And that's exactly descriptive of what it is. I'm actually improvising the entire solo line while I have the orchestration all set. And it's a really unique piece, just as unique as that first fiddle concerto.
I'm kind of curious. You are in both the folk world and the classical world. And it seems to me right off the bat that the classical world is much more competitive than the folk world. How would you compare the two?
Well, I think the professional folk world is very competitive. They've got their career tracks and their award systems, and they're competing for shows against each other, and they're trying to figure out who's going to headline the festival and who's not. It's very competitive scene. All music genres can be very competitive. And at the same time, classical music might have the rap of being very competitive, but I have found it very nurturing and very open. So, you know, the package is not always what it seems. You know, like my biggest collaborators and supporters at the University of Miami, I would have to say, was the classical string department. I mean, I certainly had a lot of support from the jazz department and the Bruce Hornsby songwriting department. But I would say the classical strings department trumped both of those. So, you know, you never know. And that's what I love about my career in music, is that it's just full of surprises and you never discount anything. And you give it a shot and you try to create bridges. And some people will get on the bridge with you, you know, and that makes it really sweet.
Mark O'Connor is on the line. His new album is called Markology 2. And before I play a song from that album, when you were young, you met Bill Monroe. What do you think he'd say about the world of bluegrass today?
Well, yeah, that's pretty easy. he didn't really like the modern stuff that we were doing when he was alive. So, but towards the end, he really embraced us. He wanted to make sure that his music had a legacy with the musicians that came after him. And so he had a mission. He was on a mission. He wanted to make sure that while we're playing all our stuff, our innovative, you know, new grass or whatever you want to call it, he wanted to make sure that we still knew Roanoke and and Mule Skinner and Jerusalem Ridge and Gold Rush and tunes that he wrote, that we would keep them in our repertoire. And I certainly have done that. I have actually put Bill Monroe tunes in my O'Connor method. And I think that he would be really satisfied with that result. I don't think that he, you know, being a life that he has and experiences that he's had. I mean, remember, he saw Elvis Presley completely turn one of his songs upside down. So he was used to that. I mean, you know, that was way back in the 50s. So he was used to that. I think that he, in the end, he was proud that he could make a contribution. And he would take us younger guys and take us in the corner and teach us stuff. You know, like Bill Monroe was doing that with me. Every time I saw him at a get-together, he would take me in the corner and show me and teach me some of the tunes that he either had been playing for a long time or that he was writing. So it was really sweet.
I enjoyed the liner notes of your new album, Markology 2, and it's how your family now. You have a family band now, and you made you more of a folk artist?
Well, they invited me back into the scene that they kind of grew up around, listening to my records and loving that stuff that inspired them. So, you know, that's really what brought me back into the scene. I wouldn't have played guitar, certainly wouldn't have played any guitar, I don't believe, without my family encouraging me to play with them and play some of the material that I was known for that inspired them to play their instruments and the styles that they wanted to learn. And so, yeah, I mean, it was really an amazing kind of journey back. And now, and then of course I'm married to Maggie, and she loves both classical music and the folk styles. And so it keeps me fully engaged in this. You know, we even sing stuff now. So she's a really fine lead singer, and I can add some harmony vocals. So things that I just, you know, might not have thought of doing as I'm up there, you know, premiering my, you know, improvised violin concerto. I'm not thinking about singing harmony to a song, but here I am. So I'm kind of doing it all still, you know.
Mark O'Connor's new album is Markology 2. And what is truly amazing is that the guitar is not even your primary instrument. The fiddle is your primary instrument.
Yeah, I mean, it's true. I mean, I would, if you went back to my teens, though, I think most people would have thought that it was about equally split because I played guitar in the David Grossman Quintet and with Stefan Grappelli. I also played violin in there too, but my prominent roles were on guitar. And then when I joined the Dregs, who incidentally had done some time in Miami, they all went to the University of Miami. When I played with the Dregs, I was both on violin and guitar, more prominently violin. I think my career was really established as a soloist when I went to Nashville and became the top fiddler and then started writing all these concertos and putting my violin prominently into a classical setting. So, the guitar's always been there. It was my first instrument, my first love. I might never have played the violin if it weren't for the guitar. So for me, there's a lot of history there, but certainly I think this guitar album is surprising a lot of people. It's, and it doesn't surprise me because it wasn't something that I had planned and I didn't actually think I could do it really. I was hoping that I could play a little bit of guitar coming back after the 20-year layoff, but to take it this far, it was so surprising to me.
Markology 2 is Mark O'Connor's new album, and I'm going to play Kamala's Boogie, and I'm surprised this is on the album. That sounds like you're gone political, Mark.
Yeah, well, we were doing our show, and then Kamala Harris was, picked for vice president. Nomination. And we just celebrated that. We thought, oh my gosh, a woman of color, if finally in our American, the hierarchy of our government and all the way potentially to the White House. So I just wrote a tune. I was working on that tune for her and I just named it Kamala Boogie. And it was just really fun. Just a very celebratory tune, and it was before they won the election, of course, so it was just the fact that she was getting recognized, and I thought that was so cool.
What in this song, there's some impromptu talking at the beginning. I hear you say E all the way down to C. What are you talking about there?
Yeah, so that actual cut from the whole album is actually the only live cut. But it's kind of funny because live for pandemic time is, from our home through streaming. So there's actually no crowd noise. So I was just telling the audience through the microphones and the cameras streaming that I'm going to tune my bottom E string all the way down to C, which is very unusual because in most guitar lingo, there's the drop D tuning, which is a really wonderful tuning. Matter of fact, Greensleeves that you just played is a drop D. But going all the way down to C with a low string is very difficult because most guitar players play with medium gauge strings or even medium lights. And I play with heavy gauge because I wanted to get this really big tone out of the Dreadnought style guitars. And I had played with heavy gauge when I was a kid, actually, and with David Grossman. And I wanted to return to that tone because, playing a violin for all these years, you really get into the beauty of the tone of the instrument. Like that's what really drives you. If you have a beautiful sounding violin and you're getting great tone, then everything kind of just fits in around it. And I wanted to approach the guitar that way. My return to the guitar, I had it in my mind that I wanted to get this beautiful big tone. So I went with the heavy gauge strings, even though it was going to be tougher on my left hand, especially getting it back in shape. But I thought, it's a challenge. I'm just going to set the mark real high, the bar real high and try to get there. And so consequently, because I've got such a heavy gauge E string, which is, I think, a 59, I can tune it all the way down to C and it won't buzz out, or it buzzes out a little bit, but it still has a lot of tone to it, which is very unusual for a guitar player to be able to do, unless they are playing with heavy gates. So that's why I was telling the audience that I'm going to turn it all the way down to C to play this new tune.
Mark O'Connor's new album is Markology 2, just a breathtaking solo acoustic album, and congratulations, Mark. I really, really think it's incredible.
Thank you so much for playing it, Michael, and everybody listening to it, and it was really a rewarding thing. I every year I think, okay, well, I may have released my last CD because I've got a lot, and but this is I was going to stop with 45. I had 45 CDs, and I thought, you know, one more, maybe one more, 46. So this is the 46th feature CD in my career, and it's a privilege to be able to return to the guitar for it.
Here's Mark O'Connor's Kamala Boogie.